Our next speaker is Kalai Mugilan. He's a diversity trainer, sociology teacher, and vice president of the Humanist Association for Middle Tennessee. He's going to speak about emotional intelligence for the humanist. Kalai?
Hey, everybody. It's a little shout out from to folks in Nashville. That's where I live. Thank you. Families watching and friends who are watching. So I'm a guest in Miami. So I teach sociology. Talking about body quotient and other quotients, this is so not cool. I'm usually outside so you can see my body. So let me work this. I call myself an expert because I teach emotional intelligence in work settings. I go to work areas and one of the big emotions is around race and gender. So I naturally have become a diversity trainer with that. I am a humanist. I teach applied sociology. My 10 weeks of class is all about emotional intelligence. In fact, I would throw the book on the floor and say, you don't need me to read the book. So what are you doing here, right? So and in all the classes in Harvard, it's all online. It's available. Knowledge is available at our fingertips. What's in the way is the question, right? So I will talk a little bit about it. I might be talking to the choir. So it is my assertion that we've been lied to. We've been lied so much that the most intelligent person or the most evolved person is a non-thinking person. That's the lie. I think we need it. I think we need it really, really bad. So it's called emotional quotient. So society constructs reality, lots of like races, it's a socially constructed reality. If you look at genes and all of that, there is no race, we still believe it and treat it as real and kill each other over it. So it's old, this is how we built it, right? Our famous humanist Gene Roddenberry with the Vulcan, I think therefore I am with Kant and you know, if you're super emotional, something's wrong with you, and you're scared all the time. I am hoping to make a case that absence of humans, what are you, right? I think we are most evolved. I also think that we have come this far because of our emotions. And partly my argument is that we are not doing perhaps as well, perhaps is due to we are not dealing with our emotions properly, all right? So there are other forms of intelligence like IQ. IQ only predicts whether you will graduate from college. That's it, done. But if you and I look at people who have quote unquote been successful and you assess them, they tend to have not necessarily high IQ, they tend to have good BQs, MQs. BQ is basically body quotient. Those are the ones who'll shake your hands and hold your arm. They will just come close to your body and make you feel very comfortable without even touching you. They know the rules of human contact really, really, really well. They probably wrestled very well when they were young. They've learned all the cues. We don't think about it. So chimps that doesn't get allowed to wrestle in the young ages don't copulate very well. So that's a whole other topic. There's MQ. MQ are the people who call you. They're no fun to work with, but they work great to work for or work together in a different way because they're the ones who call and tell you can't make it or if it can or cannot be done. They're very clear and concise about the communication. They don't beat around the bush. They go right at it. And then there is EQ. Daniel Goleman first started talking about it. You might have heard of the study if the kid candy in front of them, if they waited, they got a lot more candy. If they didn't wait, and then they followed these kids over the years, the kids who waited and didn't wait. The kids who waited seemed to be able to postpone their gratification. So it started a flurry of research and lots of information out there. So with that, I have taken it into my classrooms if this is working for me, and I have done some work on myself and how to implement this on day-to-day from one-to-one. And I believe everything is emotional, right? The list is there. Name it, including all our labels is emotional. Every one of it, race, gender, sexuality, nationality, wealth, income. I cannot think of something that is not emotional. If you do, let me know. I want to know, what is it? As a human, it is no emotions involved in it. Even learning facts, there's some emotions attached to it. Or not learning the facts, emotions attached to it. Right? Talking about what we heard earlier. So my joke is, I think not, right? I think, therefore I am. No, I feel, therefore I am. They do not go away. We know a study of epigenetics talk about it. The reason why we're still afraid of snakes and creepy things. We also know if you scare the bejesus out of a rat and attach it to a flower, and then it takes 7 generations for that rat to not be afraid of flowers. We know this. What about us? We have emotions, so many emotions. Our ancestors, just the last 100, 200 years, have gone through literally hell. Wars, killing each other over all sorts of labels. We still have it. When I talked about it in my men's group, one of the fellows said, "Now I get it. Like, what do you got?" He said, "I think I came out shaking." And I said, "You probably did." All right. What is this, right? We want to numb it out. I have a friend who, a son died, 17-year-old boy. The first thing she did, went to the doc, got some medicine, numbed out. Numbed out. She did the funeral very well. And then her life went down in the pits once it all went away. We even expect others to numb out, like, oh, keep it at the door. Don't bring it in. I cannot deal with it. I don't want to deal with it. Right? We are not sure what to do, especially if you don't know this emotion, that you might have emotions in you generations past and you cannot explain it. The best solution society has come to is numb it out. If it is lighter, distract yourself, right? Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. We distract ourselves. Food, I say food and porn and work. We have found all sorts of ways to distract ourselves. I talked about that, right? I think it makes us human. Little recap, right? We think better when we are able to work with our emotions. That's so far, like I said, I probably am talking to the choir, that you all get this. We are humans. Edwards came to town, and when I said humans are emotional, so we have to, that's who we are. All right? All right, so here I'm going to talk a little bit about what to do when emotions come up. The tip number one I have is treat it like if somebody has a big emotion, treat it like a funeral. We all know this. We intrinsically know this. We do not yell at the person. We do not tell them, your mama died, but my mama and my daddy died. We do not do that. We give them space to cry. We don't calm them down. If you notice at a funeral, we give them, hold them in a way where we don't say, get over it. We simply give them space to do whatever they need to do. And you and I know those who do not do the mourning are in trouble. We have seen it. We probably have family members who have never cried. Messed up. Their story goes away. I say, in a work setting, I say it. Have one. Create, set it up, especially even if your loved one has a big emotion. And remember, you don't have to advise. Do we advise at a funeral? Do we tell them, get over it? These are rules psychologists use. Do we bring it up afterwards? We will see them, look them in the eye, and give a different embrace, like, hey, thinking about you. That's the extent of it. We can do this with each other. I do it with students, and I'll show you a little more tricks. I have a feelings checklist up there. It's also available, I think, on the internet. A long list. Men know how to grunt at each other. We get it. That's, you know, in Sapiens, he talks about when we came down the trees, one of the things we developed our vocal cords. We know how to grunt. Men will go out and grunt. We will know what that means. We'll go for a beer for 3 hours, not speak a word, and we get it. We do, and then we'll hug each other, thank you, man. And we'll go away. So I have a list. I have, that's the list I have available for you. I did not talk about the arranged friendship, like an arranged marriage. Have an arranged friendship. If you know somebody have space for you, like they could at a funeral, if they have space for you and you can have space for them, have a very arranged friendship. Have it just for that. It's very similar to a counselor, except you're not paying, and make sure you keep the confidentiality rules. Don't advise ever. We do not like those advice, if you notice. Do not say anything to her or him. They will advise you, so do not say it. We know those people. Don't do it. Make an arrangement, an agreement not to do it. And then use a timer, exchange time. 5 minutes each, 10 minutes each. Listen, just like at a funeral. Now, I teach this to students because suicide is prevalent, not only in the above 65, the elderly white men, the young kids who struggle with it. They're not going to come to me because I'm the professor, right? They will go to each other. So I've been training them to listen to each other. If they come to you, don't advise. Be present. Don't bring it up later. Stay connected, right? One of the things I think about when I... As a humanist, one of the things to do is to notice what you're feeling. When I do feeling check, I do it with my children. When we do trips, I do it. And before coming up here, my brother-in-law didn't know about it. I was doing it myself. What am I feeling? One of the feelings that I have discussed, Me Too movements, have talks around that, guns and abortions, like, ooh, can't talk about it. Man, how can you talk about it? I do it with emotions. Give space for people to have the emotion to do it. So one of the pieces is, how lonely are you as a man, as a woman, as a humanist? You probably, some of your faces tell me you're doing it already. Yeah, it's pretty lonely. I lived in Alabama, I live in Tennessee now. That's a pretty deep question. You can even ask that when somebody gets a diagnosis of some kind of health condition. A friend of mine, he spoke for 3 hours when I called, hey, I heard they diagnosed you with testicular cancer. And my question to him was this, right? So how lonely are you with it? He said, wow, Kalai, funny you asked me that question. Let me tell you, and he spoke for 3 hours. We were both driving, so it was great. I didn't have to say a word after that. Didn't have to give him any advice either. Just let it be, all right? And ask yourself those questions, like how old, if a feeling's come up, when did you learn it? What's the real story? And you know it sometimes when you overreact. I'm like, this is not it, especially when you're around children. This is not even too much reaction. Ask yourself that question. How old is that feeling? You can ask your friends that. They will really look at you funny, but they will tell you. And when, you know, oh, it's a lot of emotions, I will simply say, how old is that feeling? Right? These are questions you can write down. I've taught managers to do that to their people when they come in, when they're like lots of emotion because something has ticked them off. Let them speak a little bit and then just ask, how old is that feeling? Remember, you don't have to advise. Don't have to do anything. You just listen. Right? And then how am I doing on time? I think I'm doing okay. All right. So the other possibility is if you've done a lot of it, you're a counselor yourself, you're pretty strong with it. If a big decision has to be made, all these emotions coming up, one of the questions to ask is, how would you act if you didn't have these emotions? If you already felt it, if you had a funeral over it, how will you think now? Your greatest clarity. So there's a definition, I'll bring it up again later, the greatest definition of intelligence or being stupid, the big S word in my home, is when I stump you with emotions around your thinking. When you're unable to think, and I only have to stump you around your emotions, nothing to do with your intelligence. And we all know when the smartest people act really bad. And it is, they've been stumped. A flick of a finger and all sorts of things will just trigger us. And then boom, we go to stupidity. Right, and we're afraid of that word. That's a big S word in the family. All right? More tips? There is water here. So here's something I do in class. So I have students come up to me and say, I have panic attacks. And I will say, let's arrange to have one. Like literally, I will reach out my hand and say, have one. They will stare at me like you're doing, some of you are doing, like, really? What WTF, right? And they will stare and say, sincerely, have one. Make sure you're safe. Make sure you don't fall. If you did, you know, have set up for it. Some I've invited, can I come to the room to do it? I'll describe the setup. They've never come. I'll let you lie down, leave the door open enough so you can run away if you need to. Lie down and have one. Make sure the reason you want to lie down is so you don't hurt yourself. Because that's what they're afraid of, right? To just be with them. And then I will occasionally remind them when they are in heavy emotions, notice I'm not scared. And I will show them that I'm smiling. Like, I'm glad you're doing this. There's another phrase that somebody does come to trust me to show me their emotion. I would say, thank you for trusting me. You've been needing to feel this. They will just, and then it's done. The funeral is over. All right? And then one of the other pieces that I've done is reinterpret emotional things like beauty. Beauty is amazing. It's a $40 billion industry. We all have met someone really attractive until they open their mouth, right? And we have experienced the opposite. We've all met someone so ugly. Like, oh Lord, they could use some help. Until they open their mouth. You want to know, you physically will move closer and say, what's your name? Where did you grow up? What do you do? What is beauty then? There are many words, like stupidity, I redefined it for you, right? There are many words. Words make up our world, and there are so many emotions attached to it. And we have to get out of it. We have to reconfigure it. One, I think the humanist message is that we don't have community. A lot of us do not have community. We get snapped away from our community, the person who gives you a hug. You know, babies die when you don't hug them. If you work at a neonatal clinic, they will get volunteers just to hold the baby. You know why? They will die if you don't hold them. And we won't even know how to hug each other. We haven't learned how to hug each other. What's a safe hug? What's a polite, comfortable touch? Right? So we have to learn this. So I think for humanists especially, we are like, so, no. To actually find ways to reach out, touch a hand, right? The boredom, my son came up with this definition. What is it like, Dad, I'm bored, he's 11. I'm like, what does it mean? And then he knows I do this, right? And he finally said, Dad, that is because I'm lazy. And I'll ask my students that, if you're bored, your brain wants so much more, and you're not giving it. It wants real stuff, not the sitcoms, and those are distractions. It really wants, the brain gets hungry. Remember the time each one of you forgot your meals and did your work, not necessarily work, but at school, a project. You were so engrossed in it, lunch didn't matter, hunger didn't matter. That's what happens to our brain when we are learning and we're excited. If that's not happening, you're wasting your time. Throw away the book. I will tell my students, if you get sleepy when you read a textbook, close it. Go to sleep. Don't waste your time. At least get some rest. Right? All right. I feel, therefore I am. That's my conclusion. Right? Then the question is, I do think we can learn how to feel our own emotions. We can learn how to be with each other. We have to do it with each other. Feeling heavy feelings alone is like a spiral down, so we are afraid of it. So have the friendship. Find someone you can do that with. You can do it over the phone. It works just as well. To be able to call or make agreements with someone to call, I will call you, having nothing to say. And then we can teach each other to do the same. All right, so that's my information. There's a list of feelings checklist that I do in my board meetings and before I begin my class. I will give everybody a sheet and say, go through the list. Tell me what you feel first before you tell me what you want me to know. I do the exact question when I do abortion, when I talk about guns. Tell me what your feelings are first. Do not respond to anybody else. Tell me what you think I need to know. And I will keep stating it, and they will state it. One last thought, and then I will do the questions. One of the other conversations piece that people, when people are willing to talk about how lonely they are in their label, I will also ask them, hey, so what's good being in that label? This is the diversity piece, right? I've asked to older white men, what's good being an old white man in the United States today? They have a lot to tell you. they will get uncomfortable because of the way I look. And then the second question is exactly the opposite. What's challenging? What's difficult? Where do you struggle being an older white male in the United States? And I don't care what they say. It's irrelevant to me. It's their story, right? And then I'll ask them, so what do you wish I knew? You know, by the third question, by the end, I do diversity trainings like that, where they segregate the group in Alabama and Tennessee, right? And then in the end, I get the biggest of hugs. They'll ask me, may I hug you, son? And I hug them back, right? Of course you can. And these are sometimes people, even as a religious groups, it's a pretty cool question. What's good? What's difficult? What's good first? You got to do what do you like first? And then what gets challenging? And then what do you wish I knew? Nothing, unless they ask you, don't ask anything. So my transgender gay students come out in my class. Anybody who's been to prison, anybody with any kind of deep story inside will want to talk about it in my class because of those three questions. They love it.